This unit consists of three programs. The program you're about to see is called Heat as Energy. This will be followed by Radiation Waves. And the third and final program in the unit will be on the radiation spectrum. But our story begins with Heat as Energy. One day, about 200 years ago in Munich, Germany, a large crowd gathered round a man called Count Rumford, who was busily boring out the barrel of a cannon. Now, this was a pretty common sight in those days, so why the crowd? Because Rumford had fitted a box round the tip of the drill, and the box was filled with water. And after the barrel had been turning on the drill for some time, the water became so hot that it began to boil. The crowd was astonished to see all this heat apparently coming from nowhere. And Rumford was pretty excited too, because he suddenly realized that the only thing that was producing the heat was the movement and the friction between the barrel and the drill. Whenever there is movement and friction between two objects, you get heat, whether you're boring the barrel of a cannon, rubbing two pieces of wood together to make a fire, or simply rubbing your hands together to keep warm. This is because when two objects move against one another, the molecules in these objects go faster. And we know that it's the speed and the mass of molecules that determines quantity of hotness or heat. Fast molecules are hotter than slow molecules. And they can use their rapid movement to make things hot for any other molecules they come in contact with. In other words, fast molecules have the ability to do work on other molecules. Now we know that ability to do work is the definition of energy itself. So when molecules move fast, not only is there a lot of heat, but there is also a lot of energy being transferred from molecule to molecule. But since movement is a form of energy, and the movement of molecules and heat are really one and the same, it follows that heat itself is also a form of energy. Now, when we looked at temperature, we saw that its unit of measurement is the degree Celsius. What is the unit of measurement of heat? Well, what is the unit of measurement of energy? The joule, of course. So logically enough, since heat is energy, the unit of measurement of heat is also the joule. We know that one joule is the amount of energy needed to exert a force of 1 newton through a distance of 1 meter. This means that if Count Rumford wants to raise this kettle of water, which has a mass of 1 kilogram, or a weight of 10 newtons, through 1 meter, he'll have to expend 10 newton meters of energy, or 10 joules of energy. But when we're dealing with heat as energy, instead of raising something through a distance, we raise its temperature through a certain number of degrees Celsius. In fact, scientists have worked out that it takes 4,200 joules of heat to raise the temperature of 1 kilogram of water by 1 degree Celsius. Let's see Count Rumford do just this with his kettle of water, which is now at 15 degrees. The Count is now moving the water with his egg beater. He's expending energy, and he's producing heat. Just enough heat to raise the temperature of the kilogram of water from 15 to 16 degrees, 1 degree Celsius. And it cost him exactly 4,200 joules of energy, or heat, to do it. story so far. Whenever there is movement and friction between two objects, you get heat. This is because the movement of molecules and heat are really one and the same. But we know that movement is a form of energy. So it follows that heat itself must also be a form of energy. That's why heat, just like energy, is measured in joules. And now, radiation waves. If you touch something that is very hot, you'll get burnt. This is because of conduction. The heat is conducted by a sort of domino effect from molecule to molecule, or from atom to atom, along the hot object and into your fingers. That's one kind of heat transfer. But if you hold your other hand above the same hot object, you will also get burnt. This is because of convection. The hot object causes the molecules of air above it to speed up. The hot air expands and becomes less dense, and is therefore conveyed upwards. That's a second kind of heat transfer. Are these the only two ways that heat can be transferred? Then why are you sitting under that beach umbrella? Because the sun's too hot? But how can the sun transfer heat to you? You're not touching it, so there can't be any conduction, can there? And since most of the space between you and the sun is just that, space, except for the thin layer of air formed by the Earth's atmosphere, there can't be any convection either, can there? Because once you get beyond our atmosphere, there's almost nothing out there to do the convecting. But the sun still feels hot. Amazing. How is that possible? Is there a third kind of heat transfer which allows heat to move through empty space? Yes, there is. And to understand it, you must first of all remember that heat is a form of energy. Now, energy can travel in various ways, but one of the chief ways in which heat energy travels is in the form of waves. Rather like the waves that a boat makes when it moves through the sea, or the waves that spread out when you drop a pebble into a pool of water, or the waves that travel along a rope if you jiggle one end of it up and down. In all these cases, what you are seeing is the effect of the movement of energy itself. By means of waves, energy can move through any distance. You can do it yourself. You can make that umbrella move without touching it. Tie one end of your rope to the umbrella, and now move your end of the rope up and down. You can actually see that your energy is traveling through the space between you and the umbrella, and then making the umbrella move. The heat energy from the sun travels like that. The sun sends out waves of heat energy in all directions. Each of them is rather like the spoke of a wheel, and this is exactly what scientists call them. Only they use the Latin word for spoke, which is radius, from which they get the word radiation, the name given to this third kind of heat transfer. So it's by means of radiation waves that the sun can transfer its heat energy to you and make your molecules go faster and therefore make you hotter. Even though the sun is millions of miles away. Just as by means of waves again, you can transfer your energy to the umbrella and make it move, even though you're standing several meters away from it. But it isn't just the sun that radiates heat in all directions. So does an ordinary fire, or a stove, or an electric light bulb. In fact, waves of heat energy are radiated to some extent by all sources of heat. Even you radiate a certain amount of heat in the form of waves. Come to think of it, there are waves everywhere. Oh, watch out. Here comes a big one now. The story so far. One of the chief ways in which heat energy moves is in the form of waves. Sources of heat, such as the sun, or a fire, or a stove, send out these waves in all directions, as if each wave were the spoke, or to use the Latin word, the radius of a wheel. This is why this third kind of heat transfer is called radiation. And now, the radiation spectrum. In warm weather, you seem to feel hotter if you're wearing black than if you're wearing white. Is this just your imagination, or are black things really warmer than white things? What could color have to do with heat? What is color anyway? Why are tomatoes red? Or oranges orange? Or buttercups yellow? Or green peas green? Or blueberries blue? Or violets violet? Where do all these colors come from? They come from light itself. White light contains all the colors. See for yourself. Go into a dark room.
Ouch.
Open a chink in the blinds and let a narrow beam of light in. Now hold a glass prism in the light beam. Look at the colors. Red, orange, yellow, green, blue, violet. That's what white light's made of. When it shines all these colors on a tomato, the tomato absorbs each of the colors, except red, which it reflects. That's why tomatoes look red. Oranges do the same. They absorb all the colors, except orange, which they reflect. So oranges look orange. Buttercups only reflect yellow, so they look yellow. The same thing applies to green peas. Blueberries and violets. Now, if you mix all these colors together again, you get white light once more, because white is simply a combination of all the colors. Your white suit appears white because it doesn't absorb any of the colors. It reflects them all. On the other hand, your black suit appears black because it absorbs all the colors. It doesn't reflect any of them. Black is simply the absence of any color. But what's all this got to do with black being warm and white being cool? Well, when the sun radiates waves of heat energy, these waves come in many different forms, which make up a whole band or spectrum of energy waves, from radio waves at one end to X-rays and gamma rays at the other. Some of this heat energy is visible. These are the light waves made up of all the different colors, but these only take up a little bit of the radiation spectrum. The rest of the spectrum isn't visible at all. There is, for example, some invisible radiation just beyond or beneath the red. Since the Latin word for beneath is infra, this is called infrared radiation. Now, most of the sun's radiant heat energy comes to us in the visible and the infrared parts of the spectrum. And that's why black is warm, because it not only absorbs the heat energy of the visible colors, but in doing so, it also tends to absorb a lot of the heat energy of the invisible infrared radiation as well. Conversely, white is cool, because it not only reflects the heat energy of the visible colors, but in doing so, it also tends to reflect a lot of the heat energy of the invisible infrared radiation. So now you know that color really does have something to do with heat. It isn't just your imagination. You also know what lies at the end of the rainbow. It isn't a pot of gold. It's infrared radiation.